Hello children, welcome to VKS's Physics Clinic, and in this class today we are going to discuss damped oscillations, which is a small portion but again it's important. Damped oscillations. What is damping actually? Damped oscillations. We have a common experience that whenever any object vibrates, then the amplitude of its vibrations go on decreasing, right? And then finally what? The vibrations will cease, they will stop. For instance, take the case of a pendulum. Pendulum is suspended with the help of this inextensible massless string. When I pull the bob aside and release, then what I find? We find that the bob travels on one side to a maximum distance, suppose up to here. Linearly it travels up to here. This is the amplitude. And then what we find? That this amplitude goes on decreasing. The decrease is very marginal, but every oscillation will have some decrease in it. For instance, I can imagine something like this. It goes up to here. Now it should go the same distance on the other side, should go up to here, but what happens is it goes up to here and then it travels a smaller distance, here again a bit smaller, again a bit smaller, again a bit smaller, goes on decreasing and decreasing, and finally the motion ceases to stop. Here the pendulum comes to rest. Actually this is damping. Damping is this gradual decrease in the amplitude of vibration. Now the question is, why this gradual decrease? We have another experiment. Suppose I take this pendulum in an evacuated chamber. I put this pendulum in an evacuated chamber where there is no air, and then I oscillate it. What will I observe? That these oscillations will continue, they will never stop. There is no damping here. The amplitude will always be same. Whatever is the displacement this side, the same will be displacement this side. If I have to draw it, I'll be drawing like this. It goes here, comes back, goes, comes back. You can see that amplitude is not decreasing, it is remaining what? Same. So these vibrations actually we call damped. And these vibrations we call what? Ideal or undamped. Clear? If I plot the displacement on the xy plane, the Cartesian plane, this is displacement and this is time. If the oscillations come like this, now these are natural oscillations or ideal oscillations. Okay. Now on the other hand, if you find that oscillations are having actually a gradually decreasing amplitude like this, this is x and this is time, so these are damped oscillations and these are natural or ideal oscillations. So children, the question is, what is practical? The practical is this and not this. Why this is practical? Because see, when the particle is moving, when it is oscillating, then it is displacing the what? Particles of the medium. It's constantly what? Having a friction with what? The particles of the medium. It has to push the particles of the medium as it has to move forward, right? And in order to push the medium particles, it has to perform certain amount of work. In other words, in order to oscillate in a medium, the oscillator has to do certain amount of work, and when you do work, what happens? Your energy gets spent, and as the energy will get spent, then your energy will decrease. As the energy will decrease, then you know, you have done already, that energy of an oscillating particle is directly proportional to square of the amplitude. So when you increase, when there will be decrease in the energy, then amplitude will also go on decreasing. And this is the reason for damping. So what are damped oscillations? amplitude. So damped oscillations are oscillations of constantly or continuously decreasing amplitude. Now I'll be saying, children, during damping, what exactly are the forces which are acting on the body? Let's take the case of, now children, let's discuss the case of an oscillating spring to which a mass has been attached. Let's imagine something like this. Here we have a spring and you have a mass M. And is mounted on a stand. Say there is a clamp stand on which it is mounted. Clear? And this is the mean position. This is the mean position here. What I do is, I pull the spring a little bit downwards. So I pull it, it will become like this. It will come something up to here. Suppose this elongation is x. This is x. Now if I elongate it by a distance x and I release, then what happens? It starts oscillating up and down. It has come down by a distance x. So it will go up again by a distance what? X. And x will become amplitude of oscillations. How much is this? This is x. So as the particle is oscillating, children, here we have air particles. Imagine the mass is coming down. As the mass is coming down, then how many forces are acting up? There are two forces. One is the force acting due to the spring. This is the spring. There are two forces, I said. One is force of spring and the other is, in fact, the force which is given by Stokes' law, right? The damping force, we call it FD. The two forces which are acting upwards. So actually these two forces together are producing the necessary damping or loss of energy in the oscillations of the block, right? So here we have damping force, actually this force is given by Stokes' law, FD is directly proportional to the what? Velocity. Minus FD is directly proportional to velocity, or FD is equal to minus B into V, where B is called damping constant. Damping constant. And remember, B is always positive. B is positive. And this negative sign here for the damping force means the force is opposite to the direction of velocity. If the velocity is down, the force is up. If the velocity of the force is down. Similarly, children, now, spring force minus Fs will be directly equal to x. Clear? Hooke's law. Then Fs will be equal to minus kx, which already know k is spring constant. So these two forces put together will be producing the necessary retardation or damping in the motion. The spring force, the damping force, and the spring force. So therefore net force will be, or total force will be, F total will be damping force plus spring force, isn't it? And total force, if I use Newton's law, second law, MA will be equal to FD is minus B into V minus K into X. Right? Now in this equation, children, we already know, but remember, this acceleration is a time dependent force, because acceleration is going to depend upon X. V will also depend upon X. So here we know, but A is equal to how much here? Second derivative of displacement, and V is equal to dx dt. If I put these values here, then M into d square x dt square is equal to minus V into dx dt minus kx. If you bring it on the left hand side, the m d square x dt square plus b into dx dt plus kx is equal to 0. So children, this equation which you have got is the equation of damped motions or damped oscillation. This is the equation of damped oscillations. You have to remember this equation of damped oscillations. Now, if you solve this equation, this is a differential equation of the second order actually. If you solve this equation, then the solution for x will have an exponential factor in it. It will have an exponential factor in it. If you solve, now children, so if this is the differential equation of second order for damped oscillations, what will be its solution for displacement at a given time t? Because the displacement x at a given time t at this block is moving x distance down or x distance up. So x will be basically what? A time dependent factor. The spring is here, right? So solutions of this equation is beyond the scope of a syllabus, so I'll just write down what we get. So displacement after time t is x t will write x after time t equals, if you solve, a into e to the power minus bt by 2m cos omega dash t plus phi. So this is the displacement of the oscillator at a given time t, where omega dash in fact is root over k by m minus b square upon 4m square, where m is the what? Mass of oscillator. Normally, if b is 0, you can see this very interesting. If b is 0, then omega dash will be what? K by m. Means angular frequency of the mass which is oscillating through the spring will be same as the ideal case where there is no damping, right? So this is omega dash. B, you know, is the damping constant, t is time t, and m is the mass of the oscillator. Now here children, for small damping, children, b by root km is very important, should be very small compared to 1. Remember this. Damping will be small, like I told you now, first case is going this much and now is coming what? This much. Very small change in displacement. So for small damping, you have to know that b by root over km should be very small compared to 1. So you can see that the displacement of the particle is basically a time variable, and we get e to the power minus bt by 2m. So that shows the displacement is what? Exponential, right? If t is infinite, then x will become how much? 0, because e to the power minus infinity is how much? 0. And if t is equal to 0, e to the power 0 is what? 1. So amplitude will be maximal in this case, and omega dash is the angular frequency of the damped oscillator, which you have already written, and you should be able to do this. This is equation 1. These are important equations, and you have to remember these equations. And this is equation 3. And this is an important condition, that for small damping, b by root over km should be very small compared to 1. Okay? So as the displacement is changing, then obviously this term is important for us. This is the net amplitude. This is the net amplitude. So what is the net amplitude, children? Net amplitude of damped oscillator. A dash, let's call it what? A dash will be A into e to the power minus bt by 2m. So this term which I was saying here, this term actually is representing the net amplitude. Okay? So this becomes our fourth equation and important expression. So as the amplitude will vary, then the energy of oscillator will also vary. So if you have to find out energy of the oscillator, we already know that E is equal to how much of half k into E square, into E dash square, because we have done energy, E is equal to what? Amplitude square. Net amplitude is what? E dash. So if I put the value of E dash here in square, then energy after time t will be half k A square e to the power minus bt by m, because these two will cancel out. Yes? So here we get another very important expression that you have to know. This is the fifth equation that you have to know, that energy of damped oscillator after time t is half k A square into e to the power minus bt by m. So what is A here? A is the amplitude of the original wave when it was not being damped. Okay, so children, we understood what exactly are the terms, like the damping constant, then equation of the damped oscillation, and then we discussed the instantaneous displacement. This is an important term for you. B by root km should be very small compared to 1. Okay, if they ask you what will be the extent of damping, will be large or small? So remember, small if it is very less compared to 1, okay, otherwise large. And net amplitude is this much, and this is energy of the oscillator at a given instant. Clear? Now once you have understood it, then we will proceed to understand what exactly is the forced vibration. Okay, let's see what is forced vibration. Now children, after discussing damped oscillations, we are discussing what are forced vibrations or forced oscillations. Forced oscillations. What is forced oscillations? You see, if you have a house which is close to the airport, then you will see that every time a plane takes off or lands, it sets, you know, rattling of your window panes, right? A very common example, if you take a tuning fork, here will be table. You take a tuning fork, strike on a rubber pad and bring it to rest on the table, you will see the table will be set into vibration, right? You have noticed that when you are playing guitar and playing a certain note, then the windows start vibrating, right? So all these things, in fact, are pointing out towards one thing, that whether it is a window of your house vibrating when the airplane is taking off or landing, or whether it is the tuning fork which is setting the table in motion, or whether it is certain tune being played and the window what? Vibrating. All these are pointing out towards a common phenomenon, that an external object which is vibrating is setting another object into vibration. The vibration of the table is being caused by what? The vibrating tuning fork. And the common example, take a rope and tie many bobs of varying lengths. This is pendulum 1, P1, pendulum 2, pendulum 3 and pendulum 4. And what you do is, you set one of the pendulums in motion. For example, you set P1 in motion. You will find that all of these pendulums will also start vibrating, and they will take the frequency of P1. They will not be vibrating with their own frequencies. Remember, every object hits its own natural frequency. But when P1 will be set into vibration, P2, P3 and P4 will also start vibrating, but not with their own natural frequencies, but with the frequency of P1. So in fact, the vibrations are being caused by the external force, and the force is what? Coming from P1, right? The interesting part is, then when these objects will vibrate because the P1 is vibrating, then they will not be vibrating with their frequencies, but they will be, suppose this has got a frequency of 100 hertz, this has got a frequency of suppose 150 hertz, this has got a frequency of 50 hertz or maybe 60 hertz, and this has also got a frequency of 60 hertz. Or any frequency, for example, let us say 70 hertz. But if P1 will oscillate, then all of these will oscillate and they will be oscillating with the frequency of P1. And how many hertz is that? 60 hertz. This is what I am trying to tell you. So, what is forced vibration? Whenever an object vibrates under the influence of an external force with the frequency of the external force, then the vibration is called what? Forced vibration. Very important that you are taking the frequency of the what? External source. You are not using your own frequency. You are not using your own natural frequency. So, let us define when forced oscillations. So, it is very important that when you will be vibrating under the influence of another external force, then you cannot use your own frequency. You will have to use the frequency of the external source. Suppose there is an object A which is vibrating and its frequency is suppose 100 hertz, and then there is another object B whose natural frequency is 60 hertz, and A starts vibrating and causes B to vibrate. So, B will be vibrating with what frequency? Frequency of A, that is how much? 100 hertz and not 60 hertz. This is to be understood very clearly. So, whenever an object vibrates under the influence of an external force with frequency of the external force, then oscillation is called forced vibrations. Clear? So, let us see what is equation of forced vibration. Equation of forced vibration. What is the equation? We will be discussing what is the equation of forced vibration. See, the external force which is setting the other object into vibration, in fact, is a periodic force. What force? Periodic force. So, I will say let external force is Ft is equal to F naught cos omega dt. Now, I am using this term Ft. Why I am using this term Ft? Because it is a periodic force, it is a time dependent force. F naught is what? Maximum force. Now, this omega d is a very interesting term. Omega d is in fact driven frequency, driven angular frequency. So, this force you have taken as a cosine function. F naught is the maximum amplitude. This force could be something like this. It will be cosine function now, it will be something like this. Clear? This is F and this is T. Right? So, this force is acting on the oscillator. But apart from this force, there will be other forces also, like there will be a damping force and there will be a spring force. So, if this is the net force acting on the oscillator, this is the external force acting on the oscillator, therefore, I will say net force on the oscillator. Net force on the oscillator is what, children? F is equal to F d plus F s plus the external force. The three forces, these two forces we have already discussed. Now, additional force has come. If I put all these values, then F becomes minus Fd. The damping force you know already, B into dx dt minus kx plus F naught cos omega d into t. Clear? Now, children, how much the value of F? F will be m times the second derivative of displacement. So if I put in the value, but f is equal to md square x dt square, the second derivative, second order derivative of displacement, if I put it here, then m d square x dt square is equal to minus b into dx dt minus kx plus f naught cos omega d into t. If I bring these negative terms on the left, so m d square x dt square plus b dx dt plus kx is equal to f naught cos omega t. Let's see, this is equation 2. So this is the equation of forced oscillation. So remember, in damped oscillations, right hand side was 0. The right hand side 0 will be replacing 0 by the net force, net external force is f naught cos omega d into t. Now if you solve this equation, then we can actually calculate what will be the net displacement of the particle. Net displacement in fact will be a function of time, so I'll be writing x at a time t is equal to a cos omega dt plus phi, where phi will be a phase difference that will be developed between the original vibrations and vibrations which are being forced by the external force, external source or the force, whatever you say. Now a is the what? Net amplitude. A is what? Net amplitude. And net amplitude, it can be shown till then, the net amplitude of the wave, A will be f naught divided by root over m square omega square minus omega d square whole square plus so this then is amplitude, that is equation 4. Net amplitude is now, why this net amplitude is crucial for us? Because we know that energy of the wave will be depending on the what? Square of the net amplitude. So net amplitude A equals to f naught, which is the maximum value or the amplitude of the external force, m square omega square minus omega d whole square squared plus omega d square base square. So now there are two cases actually that will come across. Case one is, when the frequency of the external source is far, very less compared to the frequency of the original frequency of the oscillator, okay? There are two cases. This is the net amplitude. Case one, if omega d is very small compared to omega. But what is omega? Omega is the natural frequency of the oscillator. Omega is natural frequency of the oscillator. In this case, children, this term can be ignored. Omega d square b square is negligible. You have to remember this. So if this is negligible, if I remove this term, then a becomes f naught by root over m square into omega square minus omega d square whole square. A will become how much? F naught, root is gone, m omega square minus omega d square. So if the frequency of the external source is far or very less compared to the frequency of the initial frequency of the oscillator, then this will be net amplitude, f naught by m omega square minus omega d whole square. Now the second case is very interesting. What will happen? Case 2, this equation 5, if omega is equal to omega d or omega d by omega is equal to 1, what will happen in this case? If omega is equal to omega d, then you can see that this term will become how much? Zero. Will become how much? Zero. And then this amplitude A will be equal to F naught by root over omega d square b square. So A will be how much? F naught divided by omega d to b. So children, this is a very interesting case. When the frequency of the external source is equal to natural frequency, then you can see the amplitude becomes very large. Amplitude becomes very large. And this situation is called resonance. This is known as resonance. Okay? So resonance is a special case of forced vibrations in which the frequency of the external source is equal to the natural frequency of the oscillator. And now what makes it special? Because in a resonance, the amplitude of vibration becomes very large. When amplitude of vibration becomes very large, then energy will also be very large. And if energy will be very largely more audible, it can be heard over long distance. Okay? Then the situation in which the frequency of driving force is equal to natural frequency of the body, the amplitude becomes very large. And this stage is called resonance. So we'll be defining what exactly is resonance, okay? So what is resonance? See, when frequency of the external source is equal to natural frequency of a body, then vibrations of large amplitude are produced. These vibrations are called what? Resonance, okay? So we already said here, so for resonance we'll be defining when resonance, okay. So in resonance actually the amplitude becomes very large. If you plot a graph between the amplitude and this ratio, frequency ratio, you'll find that when frequency is equal to 1, when the ratio is equal to 1, then the amplitude becomes, this is for different values of B. You can see when the value is 1, then the amplitude has become very large. Okay. Now, these graphs have been taken at different damping factors. This is B1, this is B2. Suppose B1 is 50 here, B2 is equal to 70, and B3 is equal to 100. Randomly are placed. So, smaller is the value of B, the greater will be the amplitude. But for any given value of B, remember, when this ratio is 1 here, this is 0.8, this is 0.6, on the right you can have like 1.2, 1.4. So, on the right and left of this ideal ratio, which is 1, the amplitude will go on decreasing. But here it is maximum. And it has tremendous significance in our day-to-day lives. For instance, if you've been a NCC cadet and you've been told to march, they will see that whenever you cross a bridge, you are told to break formation. Same reason. Okay? Now, transistors also work on the same. Transistors use what? LC circuit. When frequency of the transistor is equal to the frequency of the external source, then the signals of large amplitudes are produced and sound becomes what? Audible to us. We can conduct a similar experiment also. Very simple experiment. Take three bobs, one is A, the other is B, and the third one is C. You see, I'm taking A and C of the same length, so frequency of A and C will be equal. They're tied with the rope with the help of a flexible rope. If I vibrate A, then I'll find that frequency of A will be taken by B also. But then amplitude of B will not be large, amplitude of B will be small. But here I've taken A and C of equal length, so their frequencies will be equal. So if A will be set into vibration, then C will also be set into vibration. And since frequency of C is same as frequency of A, then we'll see that in C what will happen? Vibrations of large amplitudes will be produced. Clear? So this is resonance. So there are so many examples, resonance for tremendous what? Applications in day-to-day lives. So for resonance, you have to remember that frequency of the external source should be equal to the natural frequency of the oscillator. Okay. Thank you very much. Watch the video till then so they can understand these concepts. Huh? Thank you.